little bit of background first, I guess. So I'm Tank, I'm one of the co-founders of Strike Link. Set up in the US, in Florida.
Georgia.
Alright. All right. Background, I did some game dev, did some web dev, studied economics in college, started Strike Link in college. This was in 2012. Two of my buddies from school. General interests, low design, economics, games, that kind of stuff. So I focus on the product design right now, strikingly. This is a picture of us when we were just getting started. This is the summer of 2012.
Oh, that's crazy.
I told him about this thing, though.
Yeah.
Floating up in.
I'm gonna bring it back. So this is the whole startup process. We just left college. We got a room in San Francisco. Doing the whole, like, the stereotypical, like, you know, go in a garage and, like, pack for just 24 hours a day. This is one of my co-founders, David. We had one bedroom for three people. And we were just basically writing code, like, day and night for the whole summer. And trying to get a version of the product out that was actually, like, functional, that people could actually, like, use and enjoy. Before this, we had basically nothing. We had some really half-assed product that we hadn't thought through. So this is the experience. This is where it started. Later, we made some more progress. So this is our company now. We have a bunch of sites built. We launched in a bunch of different languages. We launched our mini program builder last year. Already one of the top platforms in China. We have about 200 people now and growing. We've come a long way and still going. Okay, so these are some of our user sites. All kinds of users, small businesses, individuals. You know, we want to support small businesses and individuals, make it easy for people to use technology if they don't have any tech experience. Learn the code, learn the design. That's a whole deal. Whether it's websites or mini programs, you know, same kind of mission. So I think the focus. Focus here, wanted to talk about mini programs specifically. So that has been a big focus of our company in the past year or so. We moved to China in 2013. We tried to localize, had a lot of trouble. The model just didn't quite work out in China. The same like SaaS website building model that kind of works in the West. It just doesn't, not the same environment for a few reasons. Websites aren't that big of a thing. Desktop is not that big of a thing. And then mobile websites were kind of clunky and nobody really liked them. So one of the questions, we tried out a bunch of stuff, was like, how do we localize? What can we do to localize? It seems like that China was moving very fast in internet technology, especially mobile technology. Where could we catch on? Where could we kind of like grab onto to like scale the business in China? So it took us a while to figure that out, but I mean, and mini programs came out, and we were like, yes, this is it. this is what's good. Any questions so far? Yeah.
What made you decide to come to China in the first place?
Visa problems, not a business decision. This is my co-founders are Chinese citizens, and they were not allowed to stay in the U.S. for that long. So after their tourist visas ran out, we had to get out of the country. We had no idea what we were doing at the time, so we were like, okay, we're gonna go to China just to apply for like U.S. work visas, and then like go back to the U.S. after 6 months or something. That like didn't work out. There were some legal issues, some paperwork issues, stuff kept getting delayed. So we were like, fuck it, let's just stay in China and build a thing. Eventually, we were interested in the Chinese market anyway. We're like, okay, China's an interesting place to be working on internet stuff. What could we do in China that we couldn't do elsewhere? How can we make this situation into an opportunity? That's the story.
Did you guys already have traction back in the West or back in
Small amount of traction, yes. Very small. We felt relatively confident that we could run an internet company from anywhere. And it's most of that has panned out, has like come true. We could actually run the international product from abroad. So I think that was fine. But I think the bigger deal is that we saw more opportunities after we moved to China. Yeah, and I think that's like part of the reason why we're here. Yeah. Good question. Okay, so when mini programs came out, we were you know using WeChat for a while. So like, what makes WeChat special? You guys have probably covered this, but I'll give an overview. Why is WeChat different? Why is there no WeChat in the West? So Mark Domination, they have a ton of users. Everybody uses them every day. You don't really need to use anything else. Everything kind of happens on WeChat already. There wasn't any like legacy systems that people had to deal with because people kind of went straight from nothing to WeChat. There wasn't like desktop software, which wasn't a thing. So they leapfrogged China kind of as a whole, just leapfrogged a bunch of technologies and went straight to mobile. Chat as an OS, I think that is like the paradigm that results. So chat is the operating system. The fundamental functionality of WeChat is chat, but it also overlays a ton of other functionality on top of that, which does not exist anywhere else, pretty much. So in addition to chat, there's a social graph, there's payments, there's the app store, which is like the mini program app store. There's all kinds of other stuff, you know, bill paying, transportation, all kinds of stuff. So that is what's unique. That is what's unique about WeChat. In the West, all of these different systems are separate, and they don't really talk to each other. Some of them have deals where they can like communicate with APIs, but it's hard, and you have to like, it's not as natural. But in WeChat, everything's already integrated. So like, there is no dominant mobile payment system in the West. It just doesn't exist. A lot of people are trying, a lot of people are fighting, but it's just too fragmented right now. What can you do with this? So I think this is where the flourishing happens. Many different overlay systems. What does this mean for us? What does this mean for developers? What does this mean for users? A few things. This is just a few random thoughts that could be possible with this WeChat system that couldn't be possible otherwise. Social commerce. Customers become resellers automatically. So this is when you buy something on a WeChat mini program, you can immediately share it. That's the simple flow. But in addition to sharing, I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that you could do. You could create a group to buy it with your friends. You could create a coupon that's specific to that group. You could become an active affiliate, so you actually get commission. And this is all happening like on mobile, so it's just the barrier to become like a participant in this e-commerce is very low for the buyers. So that's just one example. Offline experiences.
And we're offline.
Offline experiences. QR codes are huge in China. Not so much elsewhere. So that connection feels very natural here, the connection between the offline and online. So this whole thing about new retail, which is new, trying stuff in offline, but buying in online, that's a new experience. That creates very interesting experiences offline. But the connection between all those experiences is online. So the connection between different people, the connection between the payment system. Business management. This is something that we're very interested in. Like, how can we help small businesses either build their business, communicate with users, all kinds of stuff like that. These business tools are very difficult in general, but WeChat can make it very easy because all the systems are in one place. You can run your mini program from a mini program, for example. You can run your e-commerce shop from a mini program, like an administrative mini program. And you can see all the stats there and send promotional materials all from your phone. That's one of the big possibilities. Of course, social gaming, mini games are going to be big there was some games that came out recently, and you know, which has kind of figured that out and released more soon. So that's kind of the overview that we see of where WeChat's gonna be. We're doing all kinds of stuff in Strikingly to like take advantage of this and build stuff that provides more solutions for users. Let's see, do we have anything else? Oh yeah, so I want to do a quick demo. You can try this out yourself. This is this is one of our mini programs that you can build. So our core product is a mini program builder. So you can log on, build your own mini program, publish it, and this is an example of that. And I'll show you. So here's our editor. If you log in, this is like our actual software, the tool that you're going to use. This is just a makeup store. If you can add a new product super easily. Let's see, I'm gonna sell an iPhone. iPhone 6. Set a price, and that's all you have to do. There. So there's a new product. If you refresh the mini program now, I think you actually have to exit it and then re-enter from the QR code, from the links. You'll see your iPhone, and you can pay for it. So we're trying to make this whole process that easy. It took like, you know, 3 clicks to add a product and publish it. That's what we're trying to do. So this would be the business dashboard. You can see your order list. There are all kinds of promotional features. This is just the core like product listing, but there's all kinds of promotional features that come with this. Set your payment settings, set categories, set like coupons and flash sales, affiliate marketing or affiliate like reselling, all kinds of systems here. I'm not using any of this right now, but yeah, this is what's possible. Write blog posts. If you want to put some content in your mini program, like regularly updated content. Membership cards, so that the user can kind of maintain a relationship with the business. This like is very easy to add to your mini program. It's kind of just like a plugin. And then you'll have a list of your members, and you can communicate with your members directly. And they can get discounts and earn points and stuff like that. Yeah, that's kind of our products. So we focus on e-commerce. This is probably the most core product that we have for the mini program side. But we also have a bunch of different types of mini programs. Restaurants. Restaurants, hotels, hotel management, so you can like book rooms, blog, simple blogging, service booking, so for like nail salons, stuff like that, and showcase, if you're just like a simple promotional mini program. Yeah, so we build tools for all these different categories, and yeah, that's kind of the overview of our product. Any questions? Yeah.
Is it hard to build it?
It is not hard to build it. If you log on and you click one, you're going to be dropped directly into the editing interface.
Picasso, you meant like the Strikingly, right?
Yeah.
From the developer.
She means
you meant
your whole business. They're coding students, so they want to know more than just like
right, right.
Idea.
Okay, yeah. To build this thing, so it's complicated because you basically have to take a mini program and you abstract everything into like a bunch of parameters and settings, and then you make an interface to adjust those settings. And you have to connect with the API to make sure you have the publishing flow ready and stuff like that. So you can actually publish the content directly to WeChat. Yeah, it's hard. It's a lot of code. And we're still working on it, so we're still building out features and stuff.
How long time does it take for your team to do the
first version, we probably built it in about a month with a team of like 5 or 6 people. But I mean, this is continuous development, right? So like the prototype is usually fairly simple. I mean, this is the case for any project. You can get 80% of the work done 20% of the time if you want to release a prototype. But if you want to, you know, nail the details, if you want to make sure you catch all the edge cases, fix all the bugs, address all the user concerns, it takes a lot of time. So that's what we've been doing with a team of dozens for the past almost a year.
But dang, it went out public in January 2017, right? That's when MiniPrograms went public.
That's when MiniPrograms went public?
And then how about you? When did you release this first?
Our tool went public in August last year.
6 months time to catch up with this one and release this first prototype. It's fast, it's very fast.
Well, the thing is, we actually, before about May, everybody was very uncertain about what APIs Tencent would allow, would release. We had no idea if it was even possible to build this kind of editor, because that's up to Tencent, right? If they allow you to use, you know, connect WeChat accounts and publish these applications directly to the platform programmatically, if they allow that, then we can build this. And it ended up that they did, but we had no idea.
Mm-hmm.
So we probably started working on it in May.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not with the full team, but like, you know, we started to experiment. And then release was August. Yeah.
So
yeah.
Does anybody can make, can I go and do one tonight?
You will need some paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so Tencent requires certain registrations. Typically, you would need a business entity, Chinese business entity, to build this. It's just paperwork Tencent requires. It's not even on our side. You have to apply with Tencent to get your account approved to
mm-hmm.
do this.
Mm-hmm.
And then once it's approved, then you can hook up. You just connect it. Yeah.
So, what about foreigners?
I don't know. That's a good question. I definitely think it's possible. I don't know what the detailed process is. You just have to. It's just some paperwork. You have to probably. I don't know if you need a local entity to properly to fill the application. I'm not sure.
You have to be a business entity. It's like a Chinese kind of individual.
So Tencent's platform doesn't handle any of the. It sounds like this is just a builder tool, and you might be purposely kind of stay away from it. All that logistics side, because it gets pretty.
It's not just purposely. We can't control it. It's
right.
It's Tencent and the law. It's
right.
Not something that we have any control.
So you can't even upload it. I'm guessing you can't go verification. They have to go to Tencent for verification first, and give you their app ID and
well, Tencent has some ways to do that programmatically. To do the verification programmatically, and we hook into those APIs whenever possible.
Cool.
But It's a more involved process.
But do you help with this process?
For certain clients, but I mean, if most businesses don't usually need any help, most businesses, if they have the proper paperwork, if they're existing businesses, they can just follow some instructions and give them.
Mm-hmm.
It usually takes a few days to like wait for WeChat to approve.
Mm-hmm. So is it to sign up or to be able to actually access building it? Is it just the app ID that you guys need along with other information, but like mainly the app ID?
It's not the app ID. We actually create the app. We need the. You need to. So technically, the business owner needs to enable us, basically add us as a. I forget what the proper term is, but kind of like as a developer.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Onto the account.
Okay. Got it.
Then we can go in and change some stuff or publish stuff. Yeah.
Could you describe some of the technology stack differences between your strikingly product in the West versus the one here in WeChat? I imagine it will be vastly different.
Or tech stack? Not that different. I mean, the main difference in the tech is obviously the mini program requires you to use their special WeChat language. But that's not that big of a deal. I mean, that's just, you know,
what do you mean by WeChat language?
Because they have their own special format for like how to write HTML and CSS.
It all compiles down to JavaScript,
it's a different thing. Yeah, so they give you a framework that you have to.
You're going to.
It's just JavaScript.
I'm sorry, you would say it soon.
It's kind of like a subset of JavaScript. Like, you can't do everything. You have to.
To the rules?
Huh?
Stick to the rules?
Stick to their rules, yeah. So they have certain rules about what you can and can't do in the mini project, which is essentially just a subset of JavaScript.
I've been told that the SaaS model in China has been kind of hard to adopt, I guess, for most clients. What's
yes.
been your experience with people being willing to pay for something?
SaaS, yeah. So our model in China is predominantly not SaaS. It's mostly going through agency partners. So like an agency would buy our software in bulk and then kind of resell our product to others, to their clients. That's still the dominant model in China. We do have a SaaS product in China that runs parallel to that, but it's not as big. It just requires a different model. SaaS is not catching on. One of the biggest barriers to SaaS is that there are no automated recurring payment solutions. It doesn't exist. Probably for security reasons, because it's too easy to scan people with that. People forget about recurring payments. So I think that's just something China's not accustomed to. Yeah.
So going from living in a garage to where you are now, at what point do you felt like you made it?
Never. It's, we haven't made it. We're close to making it. So like, we're still tiny. I mean, we still have such a long way to go. There is a lot of businesses in China and in the world who need this kind of service. And you know, our product is nowhere near where we want it to be. Our user base is nowhere near where we want it to be. So I don't know. Ask me again in 40 years. Yeah.
What percentage of business is now in China versus outside China?
Right now, majority is still outside China, but the gap is closing.
So the outside China is on the strike movement?
Yes.
And how does that differentiate from Squarespace?
Strikingly, so our original philosophy with Strikingly was just to make it like dead easy. And that's still the philosophy of Strikingly. So like and we actually used Squarespace before we started Strikingly, and just we weren't that happy with it. And not just Squarespace, but like a bunch of other tools as well. So the main pain is, so I used to just build websites for clients, and the trigger was like when I would finish building a website, I would give the website to the client, and I'd be like, here's how to edit it, and they'd be like, no, I don't want to edit it, I don't want to touch it, you edit it. And I'm like, I don't want to do that. So that was kind of the trigger. I was like, even with some of these website platforms, I use WordPress, I use some of these other platforms, Weebly, Wix, Squarespace, they still don't want to edit. So I was like, maybe there has to be a tool that's so easy that these clients would actually feel comfortable editing themselves. That's what we tried to build, basically.
And has that been the case? People are happy to edit now themselves?
Yeah. So that, I mean, you have to make things like a lot simpler on the editing side. So these other website building tools, they're more optimized for designers and agencies, and not so much for the end business user. I think that's the main difference that we have. Yeah. Yes?
What's your take on Alipay's mini apps? How is it different in terms of application than WeChat's?
Alipay's, here's the issue. Here's the difference between Ali and Tencent. Ali doesn't have as much like consumer ubiquity as Tencent. Mm-hmm. WeChat is everywhere. You use it all the time. Alipay you only use for, even if you use it a lot, you only use it for specific applications, for specific purposes. WeChat is only able to do all this because they have so much ubiquity. Not just dominating like, you know, what a percentage of your day, but percentage of the population. Just because they have, those percentages are just so high, they can do stuff that nobody else can. That said, I mean, I'm not sure. Like Alibaba is still, they're obviously gonna try to push this. They wanna compete. But they don't have the consumer ubiquity yet. I don't know how they're gonna get it.
Can you tell us a little bit about your experience at YC?
Sure. Our company, we went through We went through the winter 13 class, so that was January to March in 2013. We actually applied for the previous batch and got rejected the first time. But in the rejection, we actually got motivated to like work on it for real, like work on it full time for real. Actually, the rejection was what caused us to move to San Francisco and get the garage and like work so hard. Because in the, I mean, while we were applying that first time, we kind of we met a bunch of people in the valley. We flew out there and like talked to a bunch of people to get advice and stuff, and we were just very like inspired, I guess. And we felt like this is something that we could like actually do, like for real. And so we did. So a few months after that, we just moved out and we're like, all right, we're gonna do this. YC or not, we're gonna do this. And then we applied the next time we got in, probably because they saw that we had made some progress in that time. So YC itself, it's an intense program. It's about 10 weeks. I think the biggest, there's a few things that stand out. So one is the batch itself, the batchmates, the other people on the other companies in the batch, who are all like, you know, very friendly, very supportive, also competitive, but you know, we all push each other. That was very helpful. And we all basically learn from each other, especially like, yeah, it's a tight-knit community because you're working so closely. Even if they're not on your team, you're talking to them a lot, just like bounce ideas and stuff. That was huge. The mentorship itself was really impactful. The partners of YC are all successful entrepreneurs. They've all done it before. They're not just investors. They know what it's like to operate and to build stuff. And they know what you should do and what you shouldn't do. Especially they know what you shouldn't do. they know all the pitfalls. So most of their advice is don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. Focus on this. So yeah. That really helped us like work more efficiently, basically. And then the last thing I think is the connections to press and to investors. They have the best connections. So nobody else comes to us. So we just got automatic meetings with some of the top investors in the valley just because you're attached to the YC name. And that definitely simplified the fundraising process when the batch was over. Yeah, I think that was the experience. So we got a lot out of it.
Like, what do you mean by a lot? What exactly can you achieve? Like, with what you came there and what you had in the end, except investments?
I think the most fundamental difference was our mindset. It was that we actually thought that we could actually do it after going through Y Combinator. Before, I mean, you know, this is typical for startups. You're always plagued by self-doubt. You know, just stuff that doesn't work out, stuff that could go wrong and does go wrong, whatever, all kinds of stuff. But to go through the program and see that other people have done it, other people were in your shoes, and they worked really hard and they got something done, either build a great company or whatever, it's possible. And it's a path, and it's a hard path, but it's a path. And that mindset was critical for us because it kind of professionalized us. Before then, we were a bunch of kids in a garage who were hobbyist developers trying to make some shit. But after that, we were like, okay, this is a career. This is something that we can do for a long time. Even if one company fails, like we can do startups. We kind of have that confidence. In terms of the product itself, I mean, we also wrote a ton of code. We made a lot of progress on the product itself. We got a lot more users because of that. We learned how to focus on the right things, primarily user growth. Yeah, and so it made us work faster and more efficiently.
So what did they teach you about management, the team, or?
They didn't
management
teach about management because our team was still three people. They taught about the mentality of focusing on user growth. So in YC, growth is everything. Every single week, your report basically to the partners of YC is how much did you grow this week? How many percent did you grow your user base this week? That's it. That's all they care about. Nothing else matters. So whatever it takes to get there, whatever features you need to build to get there, whatever marketing campaigns you need to run to get there, just do it. It was it was absolutely relentless. Like, don't deal with any other bullshit. Don't deal with, you know, don't hire too many people. Don't go to conferences. don't waste your time doing like side business project, especially for like flaky clients. Focus on the product, focus on the core user base, and build it. And if you get a good growth rate, riot, keep up. That was like, to distill the entire program into some advice, that's it. Just growth every single week, every single month. You have to grow.
So where did you use to make this growth?
Features is one, building features. Relentless talking to users, like talking to users every single day, as many users as you can reach every single day, through email, through voice chat, whatever, figuring out what they need, how to talk to users, how to figure out, like, you know, is there a request that they actually want, or do they want something else that they didn't say? So getting as close to the user as possible is very important. Marketing hacks, that's another thing that could give you growth. Sometimes just cold emailing bloggers, stuff like that. We cold emailed Lifehacker, and they wrote a post about us, and we got 30,000 sign-ups just from that. But we also cold emailed 30 other people. They wrote, even some of them wrote stuff, and we got zero from them. So it's just, whatever, just like, you know, some of those is just like, you gotta do it. You gotta put it. That's kind of, let's see.
What was your user growth rate from week 1 to week 10?
That's a great question. So our growth rate was about, their target that you should be shooting for is about 10% a week. We were usually hitting that, but it was wobbly. But like, it was about that. So maybe like average out, maybe 8-9% per week.
What about after demo day?
After demo day?
Yeah, about like, you know, the press and all that.
After demo day, you keep doing it. And so I think that's the beauty of the lesson, right? Like, they tell you what to do, and then after demo day, nothing changes. You keep doing exactly the same thing. You talk to users, you figure out what they want, you build a product, and you repeat. So those lessons will stick with you. Even if you move to China, those lessons will stick with you. So
we were the only company that when I signed up, sent me a follow-up email with my name for coffee. I remember that.
Yeah, so
that's
like that's another growth hack. So for example, like, you sign up with your email and 15 minutes later it's timed. You get an automatic email from our CEO that says, hey, let's get coffee. Just like a friendly way to reach out and like start a conversation with the user. And most of them obviously don't respond, but like if they do, that's great. We can figure out what they need. We can figure out like, you know, what their business does or what they want out of the service and work from there.
So follow up on Dylan's remark. I would imagine Strikingly is a very customer centric business. How what are some of the things that you guys think that you do differently that makes the customer experience that much more, you know, top notch than your competitors?
I'm not sure about what we do differently, but we do have a very high standard for customer support.
Sort of training, I guess.
Yeah, the training, the surveys about like, oh, how was your support experience? We have like ridiculously high standards for that. We want to help the user succeed. Even if the problem is not on our platform, we'll help the user figure it out. We'll spend that time. Like if the user has to figure out how to get an embed working, some like third-party embed, we'll take the time to help them out. If it doesn't take us that much time, if it takes a few minutes to like, you know, look stuff up and figure out like, oh, you know, you did this wrong or whatever, we'll fix it for them. I think that's something that we do differently. The end goal is user success, right? And the user success is not just in terms of your product. The user success is some kind of moment in their head, in the user's head, that says, okay, I'm successful. Maybe it is within your product. It's like, oh, I published your website. Maybe it's, oh, I earned my first dollar. Whatever. So, like, and what does it take to get to that success point? A lot of it is in the product. Some of it is outside the product. If we can help you with stuff that's outside the product, we will. Because we know that's what the user wants. The user wants that success point.
How do you measure your success?
That's a great question. There's a lot of different ways to do it. For many programs, for example, typically the success point is how much money our users are making on the platform. If they're getting revenue, if they're, you know, making a livelihood there, that's a very clear benefit to them. Same thing for all of our e-commerce websites. That's the, if you're selling something on your website, that's the most important metric for us.
If it's not e-commerce,
it's a little bit tricky because then the websites can be used for many different purposes. Maybe it's informational, maybe it's just a personal profile, whatever. So you can use page views for that to see how much value you're delivering to the user. You can use how much time they stick with you, how much time they keep paying for the service. It's not perfect, but you know, it's a good gauge of how much value you deliver.
When you're trying to roll out new features, what are some of the methods you use to, I guess, test your solutions before rolling them out?
That's a great question. There's a lot of different ways to do that. Depends heavily on the feature.
Yeah.
If it's a big feature, we will usually run prototypes by users many times before actually developing it. Just to make sure we understand their needs. And even before that, just like have, you know, pretty intense conversations with them just to figure out, like, is this what you actually want? Or, you know, is what you really want something else, something different. Prototyping, the release process, you could do A/B tests, you could do split releases, and you know, use a portion of your user base as the beta testers. It's a common practice. We sometimes do user interviews, just like live in person, like we ask them to use it, just watch and see if they hit any roadblocks. We look at a lot of data, just so that's the follow-up. If there are some numbers that don't line up, some numbers that we think are too high or too low, we try to investigate and see what's wrong. Maybe there was a step that's too unclear, so that's why people are not going down it.